This is sort of old home week at CSIS because this is an exit interview with Ambassador Rick Barton, who's Assistant Secretary of State for the Bureau of Conflict and Stabilization Operations. He's a beloved figure here at CSIS, and he was somebody who stood up a lot of important work on conflict and reconstruction over a period of time. Before he was at the State Department, he was at the United Nations, at the U.S. Mission to the United Nations, and was one of the ambassadors there, covering a number of the different agencies at the United Nations. He also had a period in government service in the Clinton administration where he stood up OTI. He's perceived, I think, rightly so, as the founding father of the of OTI. So I think many of you know him from that incarnation as well. You also had a previous life similar to my mentor and friend Andrew Natsios, as head of the Democratic Party of Maine, and my friend and colleague Andrew Natsios, who many of you know, was the head of the Republican Party in Massachusetts. I don't know if there's something that we can dip into, but it's really great to have you, and I know you have a lot of I'm sure a lot of people who are watching online as well, and a number of CSIS colleagues are here, but also planning to drop by to pay their respects and say hello. But, Rick, maybe what we might do is might just ask you to just spend a few minutes just reflecting a little bit on your most recent iteration of public service. I've got a couple of questions for you, but then we might open it up for a conversation with this very thoughtful audience.
Great. Well, first off, thank you very much. It's great to be back here in this beautiful new building, to see many old friends. It's always a mixed blessing to have so many good friends in an audience. Because you actually know me, so my opportunities to pontificate are lowered from an audience that doesn't have that advantage. So hopefully I won't do too much of that today. But thanks, Dan, for the introduction, and thanks to all the colleagues from a variety of different settings that I can see out here. It's always great to look out at a group of friends, and I really appreciate your taking the afternoon. I thought I'd like to set the table just by doing three things as quickly as I could so that we can get to the conversation. Excuse me. What I'd like to do is talk about our ambition as this office, this new bureau of the State Department was set up. Talk a little bit about the progress we've made, and then spend some time on things we still need to do. What's the unfinished business? Because in Washington, in this kind of a job, there's always plenty that remains to be done. And I'd like to draw your attention to what I think is perhaps most important. In terms of what did we set out to do when this bureau was created? The first thing that we wanted to do is we wanted to improve the U.S. government's coherence and effectiveness in conflict settings. There had been a mixed record over the prior couple of decades, mm-hmm. and you could probably go back several decades. So there wasn't a big argument there. There was a whole QDDR process that said we need to do better. And what we thought we needed to do was to address the analytical overview, the places that we worked, the organization, the talent, the partnerships, and the money. So pretty much everything needed to be addressed. And we start off with a period of very dramatic change. I've likened it at various times to a merger, a hostile takeover, a startup, a turnaround, all blended in one in a change-resistant bureaucracy during fiscally constrained times with a very tight timetable. So I remember describing this to a consultant who came in once and offered her help, and she said, "Did somebody set you up to fail?" Mm. And so as evidence that I was probably the right person for the job, I hadn't even considered that. So a high degree of naivete is a useful quality when facing these kinds of challenges. So let's talk a little bit about the progress. How do we do? Well, the first thing that we try to do is to narrow our focus. And we want it to be in places that mattered to the United States at an opportune time when there was something we felt the United States could do that would actually make a difference. That screen got us made a number of decisions for us very early on. We decided to get out of Afghanistan. There were a lot of other parts of the United States government that were doing many, many things.
Our bureau
out of Afghanistan. So we were among the first parts of the U.S. government to say, okay, so much for this. But there were a lot of other people doing good things there, and it was just a question of what was the value added going to be for our bureau to be there. We did the same thing for South Sudan for very different reasons. And then we really tried to pick a series of countries around the world that we could work in. So we did Kenya, Honduras, Burma, Syria, Nigeria, Bangladesh followed on, and a number of other countries. But we felt those were places that there were particular opportunities for the United States at this time that might make the greatest difference. We tried to build a team of conflict specialists and give them some available liquidity so that they could actually go to places and be able to do something right away. And we wanted them to emphasize local solutions because really the United States is not a great occupier of other countries and does not have an interest in staying for decades and really turning them around in that way. It hasn't done particularly well in that space. And we wanted to be able to do things right away. We thought that there was a competitive advantage in the U.S. government that there are a lot of people take a year or two or more to really get going, and that if we got started faster, that would be a space that we could work in. And a lot of the local solutions were based on something that actually Terry Myers helped us with. Terry, right here near the front, helped us with in Indonesia back in the 1990s, where he put together, he was the USAID mission director. He put together a wonderful group of Indonesians who served as a kind of a senior board of directors for a locally owned initiative that wasn't dependent on the government, it wasn't dependent on a single part of civil society, but it was a rich cross-section of the most positive people in Indonesia. And we were able to work with them, and we've replicated that in a variety of other ways in other places, most recently in Nigeria, but some of the work we did in Honduras had elements of that, and obviously what we did in Kenya during the election-related violence there with Champions for Peace was built on that. And the final thing we tried to do is we tried to develop trust relationships with key bureaus, USAID, DOD, about 20 or so ambassadors and embassies. And what we tried to do as much as possible was to build off of existing platforms, so we did not have to. So it wasn't about the United States coming in and doing something totally new. It was about taking advantage of something that was there, and how do you make it grow? How do you make it more productive? So it's been a fairly intense 3 years to do these things. I'm happy to try to capture them in three or four minutes. But it does leave some unfinished business. So just to provoke some of your favorite theories and questions, let me just leave some of the things that I think we still have to do. Number one, we really have to recognize that that there's a new era of conflict. There's something almost sentimental about about what Putin is doing in the Ukraine. It's so different.
It's so old school.
it's such a throwback. But it's really not what we're facing most places, most of the time these days. And that recognition...
Something out of Austin Powers, right? I mean, it's...
so we really have to let the analysis of the data drive what we do as opposed to our favorite, oftentimes antiquated approaches. And of course, we have huge institutional biases and industries that are driving us to do things in very familiar ways here in Washington, but the unfamiliar should be embraced, and we really need to, otherwise we're really not going to be that effective. The second thing is we have to exploit these global changes to our advantage. It is to our advantage that we have these significant silenced majorities in virtually every country on Earth these days, starting with women. Okay, that's half the people in most countries. And then you throw in the fact that the demographic is very young, and youth, well, okay, that gets us another 25% who aren't women. And so now you're about 75%. The business community typically has to be on the winning side. So they're political.
They generally like stability.
And they like stability, so they have a slightly different approach to this. And then, of course, minorities and others that have to be on the winning side for their own survival. So you start with these large blocks of populations that are instinctively looking for change, instinctively want to have more inclusive governance. They have not been part of the decision-making process. And that's really very much what we're looking for in many of these places, however we express it. The third thing I'd like to mention is that these are obviously closely related, is that we need to bring together those who practice what I like to refer to as asymmetric diplomacy. So the people who seem to be most valuable in our political process right now in Washington are people who are kind of recognizing these changes and are actually adjusting their practices. So I think you could probably make the argument that among the parts of the military, of the defense establishment that are most prized by people right now are people who are able to move into the space. I believe that OTI and some others in the development community who have proven to be a bit more agile and a bit more opportunistic about what's being offered in these places have taken on a greater importance than the size of the organization or their budget would otherwise indicate. And the same for, obviously, diplomats who are willing to practice in a somewhat more open fashion and recognize that it's going to be hard to get an embassy open or hard to get onto an embassy or a lot of the kinds of restrictions that are taking place these days. You still have to get the analysis. You still have to get the on-the-ground insight. You still have to do an awful lot of what we want from these people. But we cannot just say we'll have a new era of expeditionary diplomacy and then not get them into the country in the first place. That doesn't really serve much of an answer. So, and then the final point I'd like to make just in terms of a change is that within the bureaucracy, we obviously have to come together, we have to stay together, we have to avoid the natural bureaucratic fractionalization. There seems to be a tendency in almost every discussion for people to think where they sit. So if they represent an office or a bureau or a department or whatever it happens to be, you can almost always count on what they're going to say. And to me, that increases caution, which I think we have probably in excess here in Washington. One of my favorite exercises over the last few months has been to ask my colleagues in the State Department, if we had a virtuous scale, and on one end of the scale was native caution, a wonderful quality, and on the other end of the scale is American ingenuity, also a wonderful quality, where do you think we are here at the State Department? And it probably won't surprise too many of you to hear that 95% of the answers say, we're right up here against native caution. And the other 5% say, we're over here on native caution. So nobody features that American ingenuity is actually one of our calling cards. And having been at the UN for a couple years, our colleagues, the other countries, look to the United States for ideas.
Amen.
For solutions, for problem solving.
I agree.
And much less for, gee, you can't do it for this reason, you can't do it for that reason, which generally is a big part of our conversations inside of the government, for those of you who've had the benefit, and I see a number of you have had the benefit of being inside and outside. So it's not that there's a recklessness that will result. I'm not worried about that in Washington. I'm really much worried about the creativity zone and the space and making sure that we move to that. So I just want you to know most of all that I have found this 5-year period to be extraordinarily challenging, very rewarding. I've had wonderful colleagues. I'm optimistic about what we can do. I wish I had done more, but I've been very pleased with the opportunity and the honor of serving the president, two really fine secretaries of state, and a number of colleagues who are here in the room, plus those who are not. So thank you all for coming today, and I'll look forward to your encomiums and a few questions.
Now I'm hoping next summer we're gonna go skiing together in Argentina. So you have to put that in your to-do list. One of the things Rick spent some time growing up in Argentina. Rick was born in Argentina, so he cannot run for president, unfortunately, of the United States. But you can run for president of Argentina. So that may be one of the things you could consider doing, actually. But
you know, it's actually I don't want to get into a constitutional argument here. But my father was a diplomat.
That's right.
And so
McCain had this.
So the hospital bed that my mother was birthed me on was U.S. territory.
This is McCain had this because he was born in Panama.
But the good news for all of you is there is no draft.
That's right. That's right. So
sleep well tonight.
Sleep well tonight. So Rick, I've got several questions for you, and I know there'll be others in the audience. But could you just talk a little bit about you spent a lot of time here at CSIS. You were at OTI. You're at the UN. You've been at the State Department now. Can you explain why it's I think you've talked about some of the things that need to be done. Could you just spend a little bit of time, and some of your suggestions are implied in what the diagnosis is, but why is it so hard for the United States to do conflict or do reconstruction? What is it? Is it genetic? Is it the arrangement of our government? Is it the ADD in our political life? What is it about us that we don't, we don't do this well, where this isn't something that we do well, but we've been bumping up against this increasingly in a number of different contexts. Obviously, Afghanistan and Iraq are the ones that sit there, but those are, as you just described, there's a whole universe of other countries we could talk about. But
I think it starts with a certain immodesty. I don't know how well any of you do with a friend who has a problem or a child who has a problem, but I find that the space that I'm able to influence events is usually very cleanly defined, usually by the behaviors of the person that I'm helping. And I don't know that it gets that much easier when I'm suddenly thinking about 160 million Nigerians or 200 million Indonesians or 180 million Bangladeshis or whatever. It shouldn't really get easier. In fact, it should get a whole heck of a lot more complicated. That would be my base assumption. So I think our natural instinct to solve problems is a wonderful instinct, and our ability to bring resources to it. And really one of the greatest gifts of all being an American is that you're actually invited to these conversations. The Chinese are hardly ever invited to the conversation. It's okay if they build me a new university outside of the city, but I don't really want them to help me with a difficult political problem that has subtlety to it. And that's true of just about every other country and your immediate neighbors. So we are asked to every one of these conversations. That has a natural inflating effect. It naturally makes you feel kind of more important. And even as a relatively modest U.S. ambassador at the UN, there is a feeling that some people are actually waiting to hear me, whereas some of the other countries you sort of think, they're going to have to say something clever to be heard today. So we start with that natural advantage, but you can't overplay it. And it would be the advantage of being a friend or being a parent or whatever else. You cannot overplay that. So I think that would be the first thing. I think the second thing is that with that mindset, we oftentimes miss the enormity of the task. So even getting a single friend to change, let's say,
quit smoking.
Yeah, or quit smoking. My wife smoked for the first decade of our marriage at least, and I can assure you that my influence was modest. It wasn't because I didn't have the facts and the arguments. Even a moral high ground was given to me over time. But so I think that what I really noticed in particular in Iraq was the enormity of the task was so underestimated. And so there we were. Now, the things you were describing, our organizational structure is absolutely not set up for this. And one of the places that I would like to see, I believe there are little things that could make a huge difference. And in fact, and that's the way you have to work in these countries as well. And that's the way you generally work on any problem. You take a big problem and you try to figure out, how do I make an elephant? How do I get if I'm starving, how do I get a bite out of a live elephant? Well, right away you think, I'm going to wait till he falls asleep. I mean, or whatever. I mean, there's some really practical.
There's some insight.
There's something that's going to be, okay, now I got a shot at this. And so I think that the very little bureaucratic thing that I think could be done is, I believe whenever there's a crisis coming or a crisis shaping up, that the State Department, because it is the logical convener, because it has the natural advantage of having the ambassador in the country, and you cannot really do anything in a country without the ambassador. You can't get into the country if you're AID or you're the Defense Department, unless the crisis gets way over the top. So use the State Department as the natural convener, but force the State Department and AID in particular to come together in the first 24 hours of a designated crisis, and whether it's a big one or a little one, the same process, where you have the Undersecretary for Wendy Sherman, the Deputy at AID, and the Undersecretary for J, like a Sarah Sewell. Those three people within 24 or 48 hours should be responsible for giving the Secretary of State the name or the names of two or three people who would actually serve as the center of gravity for the crisis. And let that person move, have the authority to move money, have the authority to move people, have a standing board of directors, which, so if it's a humanitarian case, or let's say it's a tsunami and a nuclear meltdown, that's a very different kind of a leader than if it happens to be the CAR or thousands of people being killed on the streets. And it's probably gonna have more of a multilateral feeling. So the nature of the, but what we do now is we don't really, we're worried that we're gonna create another Holbrooke, which scares the entire institution. But somewhere between Richard Holbrook and a Harry desk officer, we should be able to find somebody who could actually be capable enough to run meetings 24/7, call us together, say we're spending $800 million in Kenya, we have an election coming up, election-related violence could flatten everything in the country, we're spending $600 million on AIDS, we love AIDS, would they please go to the Hill and make the argument
that we ought to rejigger some of the money.
Yeah, that's, I mean, so the agility of people, the liquidity, and then, but then the strategic focus. What are the three most important things? Because the minute you put a problem on the table, what you always hear is, I'm helping out. And so 10 people doing their best, everybody offering what they normally do, but a little bit better than usual. And I've had, some of you were at this conversation the other day at Hopkins that Sandra and Susan and others were at, but I've had people who have consistently felt that they could go into almost any case and make it better. But when we went to when we looked at the Syria case, we asked people, all those people, we got them all together in our room. This is one of the things the CSO can really help to do. And we said, if all of us do our work as well as we possibly could, how do we think things are going to go in Syria over the next 6 months? And guess what the consensus was in the room? With all of us exceeding our normal performance, the consensus was that things would get worse.
God.
So given that, your natural instinct would be, maybe we have to think about what else we might do, how we would do it differently. That would be a normal human condition. But no, what we generally do is we go back and say, how do we do more of what we're doing already? And if we could just do more of this or that. So I believe that a simple organizational structure forces people to put forward good names, not just retired ambassadors and retired generals, not just an underemployed colleague, but you actually have to find somebody that you feel has leadership quality. And I have to say, one of the most exciting opportunities I had in my life, and why I go back to this example, this model, is that when Brian Atwood was running AID and then we had the Kosovo crisis, he asked me, and I was out of place in the bureaucracy, to be that coordinator for AID. And of course, the Geographic Bureau was in shock. But then within 2 weeks, they realized that almost everybody who was working on my team was from, so they had enough spies there to make sure I wasn't getting out of line, you know, whatever. So, you know.
That's exactly.
I mean, that's sort of how it works. So let's acknowledge the really basics, the real simple things, and deal with it. Anyway, long answer, but I hope
let me ask a little bit. You've touched on this. Could you just further elaborate on the aid state relationship? You've talked about it in a number of different ways, but just a little bit further. You've been at both, you've seen both sides now, and you've been an ambassador. So you've been at main state, you've been at an ambassador, and you've been at AID. So I think you've described sort of one ideal situation in the form of a crisis is how should, especially, and I think you've implied on some of the ways this should work, but you might just elaborate a little bit further, because I'm sure this is one of the questions in the room.
Well, and it's not just aid state, but it's
military.
State with a lot of people. The State Department can always do a better job of being more inclusive, of being more respectful of others' views. There's a little bit of a caste system in this town, and there is even within the State Department. Obviously, we have Foreign Service officers, and then we have political appointees who may or may not be. The caste system at times are above or below of an FSO, and then we have civil servants, and then we have a lot of other folks, and it's just not very American. So it's not the healthiest quality of our institution. I think of these relationships as being fraught with potential. So they could be a ton better. So having given the critique of state, I would offer a critique of AID, which is constant insecurity. Some of it...
We're always afraid we're going to have our lunch money, taking our lunch money away.
It's the little rich kid comes in the room, somebody going to pick my pocket. I mean, come on. Come with ideas, come with solutions, and don't worry about being bullied at the table. There are, and if there are bullying behaviors, call them out. So it's kind of an interesting business. I don't think this is totally true, but people have said that the State Department is passive aggressive. They've said that AID is passive passive, and they've said that the Defense Department is aggressive aggressive. I don't know that any of that is true, but it doesn't lead to a sort of a family of three siblings. I happen to be the youngest.
It's like a dysfunctional family.
These are fairly fundamental qualities. And again, they obviously are overcome by wonderful people who work through it, great ambassadors in the country who make the country team feel perfect, great mission directors who find a way to deal with a difficult ambassador or not. It's so human. I don't want to keep bringing everything back to the human dimension here, but
A lot of it's human.
We have the potential to really make these things work a lot better than they do, and a certain impatience with them. Many of us have become enablers because it's what people say, I know how to get things done. It's like, well, yeah, but you've got it done in a way that has created the most exotic maze that nobody else will be able to ever do it this way.
Well, okay, So when I hear around town about the Foreign Assistance Act, and there's discussions about, there was some push by former Congressman Berman to try and fix some of this congressionally, there was some sense that at the State Department, some people said, no, don't mess, we know how to work this Rube Goldberg system, don't go that direction. Could you just, based on all what you've just said, what do you think that there needs to be some sort of congressional fix to the current maze of the things that we have currently, or
if they could do it, it'd be great. They haven't had a
1986 was a partial one.
Yeah, they haven't had an authorization
since 1986.
It'd be wonderful. It'd be a good challenge. I happen to think that actually CSO has benefited greatly from the conversation that CSIS was a big part of, but that Senator Lugar initiated. And actually one of the nicest compliments that I've heard in this last month, where my deputy says you're in the halo effect period, where everything I do will be heralded. And so it's not bad, actually, because it's not the State Department's not so affirming that you can't stand a month of compliments. But one of the things that somebody said to me, who's working on our Syria portfolio, not for the department, Syria portfolio, he said, the way that CSO is working now is fulfilling some of Senator Lugar's biggest dreams. And I thought that was very, very flattering. And he was trying to think about how you solve this. And Congressman Berman was doing the same thing. I mean, they're trying to figure out, hey, if we can't make it work on a human level, let's make it work through a restructuring and rules. I tend to be somebody who feels that a lot of the reorganizations that people go through are overwrought, and that we should spend more time on actually just showing the sincerity of our commitment to change in our daily behaviors, and then let's go for the bigger fix, because bigger fix by that point won't need to be as big. So.
Yeah, I tend to agree with that. All right, look, I want to give some time for some very thoughtful people to have some questions. So if you'll raise your hands, I'll call on you.
I'll be interested to see if any of my employees.
I know, loaded questions. We're gonna start with this woman up front.
Just when you ask the question, just turn around.
We'll bunch them together. We'll do this World Bank style. We'll get this woman up front, and then I'm gonna get Michael Levitt back there, and then this woman here. So this woman, and then Michael. We'll do these three, and then we'll do another round.
I'll see if I can remember all three questions.
Yeah, and I would just, if you don't mind, I would say within the context of, say, starting January the 20th, 2017, right? In that context. So, and then let's have this woman up next over here, Jeremiah. This woman first, and this, and then we'll get you in the next round, and then I'm gonna get Michael.
Should I start again?
This one, yes.
Patricia Fagan, Georgetown University. And I want to follow up with a similar kind of question to the last person, and that is, you gave the example of how even the very best effort of the very best people in Syria would probably not yield results that anybody would applaud, much as they would want to do that. But surely, I mean, you've had successes in this job. This job has not gone badly every single case. So what's meant with the countries you have here, Syria, okay, not so great. Burma, Honduras, Bangladesh, Kenya, and Nigeria. None of them are cases to celebrate. None of them have problems that have been solved. But where would the successes be? And how would you define an anatomy of a success, including what allies were most helpful in making whatever the initiative CSO was work?
Sure.
Okay.
Sure.
Michael Levitt.
Thank you, thank you. Having had the pleasure of both working for Dick Sklar in Kosovo and surviving that, and being a CPA contract survivor, I've been fascinated by CSO from the first time you spoke here at the old building 3 years ago, whatever it was. And you made a couple of big points. We're not gonna compete with OTI, we're not gonna compete with AID, we're gonna be different, and one of the ways you made this point, was we have to act quickly. We have to be able to be measured in 6 and 9 month components. And I'm wondering, and I've tried to keep up with your weekly non-classified report, what are the results in the countries? You named some countries, are they more stable? Are they more peaceful? Are they better off because of CSO initiatives?
Okay, we'll just keep those. Those are
sure. Okay, well, let me sort of take those last two questions and then the advice to a successor. I haven't prepared my three envelopes yet. So that's a good question, and I need another second to think about it. Maybe double back with better answers as the afternoon goes on. But in terms of solving problems, I think that the ambition in working in these places should be to advance peaceful, democratic change. That doesn't mean that you have solved the problem, but you are trying to give people, in particular the people of the place, the capacity to have a fighting chance to make it on their own. And that's my ambition. I think that's still wildly ambitious. But it isn't full ownership of the problem, or gee, you haven't made all these changes yet. So having said that, I do feel as if we've made real progress. I think Kenya was an interesting case. It had obviously had a very violent prior election where over 1,000 people had been killed, hundreds of thousands of people had left their houses and had to flee. And It was clear that the possibility of that happening again was great. Now, we were able to identify a way to work in the country, and we started with the two places that we thought were most likely to be most volatile. But we were also able to bring together a really unlikely cast of characters. So one of the most uplifting meetings that I've ever been to in my career was sitting with the dozen or so recipients of the greatest amount of U.S. assistance that the AID democracy officer had brought together out in the Rift Valley, and to ask, and the conversation went something like this, because we had 1 hour to sort of see whether we could mobilize this group of people into doing something they otherwise would not normally do. And the conversation went like this. What do you think is the biggest problem facing your country this year? Election-related violence. Are you doing everything that you could to help address that? No. Would you like to do more? Yes. What might you do? First person to speak, I run a horticulture program in this area. I only have 4,000 farmers in my program, and I don't know what I could do. So the conversation then went to this point. I said, look, I've had a background in American politics, and if you start with 4,000 farmers, I could be elected governor of any state except for Texas next year. and somehow, every Kenyan in the room got it. Okay? They seem to have a picture of Texas. They seem to understand what 4,000 farmers moving the same direction might look like. So there we go. So then the next person was emboldened by that. And she said, well, we only visit 225,000 households a week in this region to check up on AIDS. And that seems to be kind of an interesting resource. So we
focused, that's kind of a big number.
Yeah, it seemed like a big number. So we focused on early warning, early response. Now, we couldn't possibly get Americans over there in the space of time that was available, the 3 months that were available before the election. But they all offered, if you could help us pay for an additional staffer or two that we can identify in the next few weeks, we will turn this asset into something that will work with the police and with this other, the usual suspects, and see if we can have more impact on early warning, early response. And that's, so there was a Champions of Peace initiative. 200 people were hired. We were able to move the money in 6 weeks through a couple of international NGOs, but all to local hiring. We didn't have to vet the people. We didn't have to hire them. We didn't have to do any of the stuff that you normally do if it's a U.S. program. So Honduras, the same thing. There was a wonderful, wonderful group of civil society people called the Alianza, the broadest coalition ever. They came together. They've had a huge influence on getting rid of a bad attorney general, on coming together and making sure that the presidential election did not run away from the homicides and the huge violence in the society. But it doesn't mean that the homicide rate has dropped yet. They've also had an influence on people being prosecuted, investigations and prosecutions successful of homicides, things that weren't happening before. So a lot of this stuff is just getting the muscle memory. And by the way, an awful lot of what you end up doing in the bureaucracy is getting the muscle memory so that you hope that the next couple of generations of people will actually do things differently as opposed to falling back on kind of the more familiar habits. So I feel as if we made progress. I think in Burma, the United States had three issues that we were interested in on the strategic level in Burma. One was we want to open the political process. Two, we want to deal with the ethnic conflicts that have existed there for decades now. And number three, we want to do business. It turns out that doing business with Burma is not that hard. A lot of people want to do it, and there's a lot going on. It doesn't need that much U.S. assistance, although it's not bad. And there's good assistance to be offered there, obviously, telecommunications industry, whatever that's going to go in there. But the political process has its own internal rhythm. Nobody really wanted to deal with the most delicate problem of all these ethnic groups and what do we deal with them and how do we come to a national, some sort of a national ceasefire. We're about to get to a national ceasefire. It's taken a couple years. That will be, and every single month I've been told it's going to happen this month. So I think it will happen in the next couple months. So I do feel that there's progress taking place, but you should be modest enough to look for progress and things going in the right direction rather than that we're there to correct it.
All right, so how about this issue of January 2017, new Secretary of State?
Well, I still believe that you have to have integrated teams in this day and age. So you cannot have everybody doing their best work separately and incoherently. I do at the heart of it, and I do believe that that's something that CSO has plenty of work to do, but it should be not as the lead, but as the guarantor that the coherence and the integration of teams is happening. And the earlier it happens, the less likely we are to suffer the sort of sprawling U.S. interventions that somehow produce less than the sum of their parts. So I still believe that's probably one of the most logical things we could do. I do think that creating, not having quite so much entitlement within the U.S. government. So if it's AID, we're entitled to do this. If it's the Geographic Bureau, we're entitled to running this. There should be a more meritocratic system, because that's kind of American. You get this because you've always done it. I'm okay with three people having different human rights arguments. And I've been in meetings in the White House where somebody has said, I know I'm stepping way outside of my lane here, and it's been by far the best contribution at the meeting.
So all right, so let's hear from Sarah, and then this woman here, and then we'll also hear from this gentleman here. So Sarah, this woman, and this gentleman over here.
Hi, Sarah Mendelson, former USAID, current CSIS, former CSIS. Rick, we're old friends, so I'm going to take advantage and push you a little bit. I've been struggling to understand what the comparative advantage and distinctive value of CSO is. And I greatly benefited from, I don't know if you were calling them tabletops, but sort of gathering interagency to talk about Zimbabwe and various futures. I have to push back on the characterization of Kenya. Kenya was an extraordinary experience from June, July 2010 through March 2013. The interagency worked better together on that one set of issues than I saw any other issue. And still trying to understand why it worked well on Kenya. CSO was a piece, but it was a huge interagency
absolutely.
Part of it. And I think, you know, lots of Kenyans will find that it was not a terrific outcome.
Yeah, the results of it.
But in terms of a bureaucratic machinery, it actually worked quite well. So my question to you is, I hear you talking about integration, and I just don't see, and you've yourself outlined how bureaucratically what the challenges are. We were always in Dacha trying to, not just OTI, but OFTA, DRG Center, CMM. What is the comparative advantage? What does CSO do that we can't do that we need CSO to do? Because there's so much work to be done. Mm-hmm. And when we figure that out, it goes like grease, right? It moves easily. But if it doesn't, there is this friction. And I think it's too easy sort of fall back to say, well, AID is insecure. I don't think a lot of my colleagues are insecure. I think that they're incredibly busy. And if they feel that they're being put in a box to only do natural disasters when there's a huge amount of equity on the political side, that's a misuse of both Dacha toolbox and the larger USAID. So I mean, I think it's complicated, but really trying to understand the three or four or two things that CSO brings to the table rather than the integrated piece, because I think people are gonna constantly push back on the integration.
Sure.
Okay, let's get this woman here, this woman, and then I'm gonna call on Ed Fox. Those are gonna be the four.
Hi, Ambassador Barton. I don't know if it's been a long time, but I'm Grace Kong, and I was in the CRC. I was sitting in INL, and I have a number of questions, but I'll just zero in on this as a concrete
example. One question.
Just one. It has to do with this effort to have greater interagency cooperation, and this is actually inter-bureau within the State Department. I was asked by CSO to help out with something I had been working on with Haiti, and a woman there wanted me to be her deputy, and I really wanted to do it, and so because of this bizarre way the bureaucracy is set up, I had to ask the office director in my INL office if I could go ahead and work with the CSO person, and CSO was paying my salary, but the INL person said, no, we want her to work on something here. Mm-hmm. And frankly, I did not think it was that significant, but I couldn't fight it. CSO didn't fight, they just deferred to the other bureaus, and so I ended up not being able to do what I really wanted to do and what I was hired for, which was a CSO job. So that's a very concrete example
of some HR issues within the State Department and how you want to bring talent from one part to the other, right?
Well, no, it's not.
My gentle issue. Way of suggesting that. I'm going to ask everyone to briefly, I'm going to ask you to go and then you to go, and each of you are going to be brief, and so get 20 seconds to wrap up.
Okay, so it was not an HR issue. It was all about leadership in one bureau refusing to try to exert leadership over another person. And I, so please explain when you say you want greater interagency or greater coordination, but yet in my concrete experience, no one was willing to exercise it.
Okay, thank you. Okay, sir.
Bill Anderson, former USAID. Thanks very much. My question is on conflict prevention, which was, as I understand, part of your brief, CSO. My question is there any unit, department, agency of the U.S. government that has the lead with authorities, proper authorities and sufficient staff and resources to, in fact, develop a strategy, lead in conflict prevention? I don't see one. And if not, how should that be structured?
Thank you for modeling brief. That's great. Ed, yes. You're going to be the model of brevity as well. Ed Fox, here's the microphone.
Never known for that. I'm Ed Fox, as a former Assistant Secretary of State and Assistant Administrator of AID. I learned to do the splits a long time ago. I would just point out that we have a strange thing going on. USAID was created by President Kennedy to pull together all the various Marshall Plan and other organizations so that we could have it concentrated in one place so the government could focus. Over time, it's just gone all over the place, and it's getting much worse. We now have whole of government, which means everybody can jump into the pool, and everybody wants to do their own thing. I remember when Condi Rice was testifying, and she was asked a few years ago, how much money do you have for democracy? She couldn't answer that because she didn't control all the programs, which is what led to the F process. So we got this tug of war where people don't have real assignments that they know are theirs. There's no expertise. We're farming out everything we're doing. AID doesn't implement anymore, so we're relying on a whole bunch of private sector people. And the president comes up with PEPFAR, and he doesn't give it to AID because he knows AID isn't well-liked, it isn't well-structured, and he doesn't because he doesn't have the political will to change AID.
This was President Bush.
President Bush. And it's the same thing with MCC. He doesn't use any of the existing structures. You create a new one. So you're spreading it around, creating more centers of power and less coordination. Mm-hmm. And so here we are with whole of government. We got a huge Ebola crisis. And what's the president do? He sends 3,000 people from the military over there. Instead of putting a civilian face on this thing, undermines certainly the image and the personal views of all people who are working in the civilian side of this thing. I just think that, you know, your tasks are great, but it's larger than you. It's the whole governmental structure. We have to decide, is it better to focus attention and put authority in one place, or are we going to just proliferate and have everybody doing everything?
Okay.
Well, let me just start on the last one. Actually, one of the places where there's the greatest clarity in the entire U.S. government is when you get into a country, and the ambassador actually has a pretty clear lead responsibility. I know that Mark Bellamy's here, but people, you can't even get into the country with your program, with your money or anything else, unless you get country clearance. And it starts, it's not a bad example. To me, it works quite well. You can't get in as a COCOM if the ambassador doesn't want you there. So we're capable of doing it. It doesn't mean that every ambassador is brilliant or anything else, but anyway, there's a model there that it does work, and that's one of my major arguments, is that we need to create an equally clear center of gravity or leadership model here in Washington. I happen to think that it's more likely to reside at the State Department than anywhere else, because you don't really get much convening authority in the Defense Department or AID, who are the other two places. If AID calls a meeting, it doesn't get everybody from all over the government. That's just it doesn't have that natural advantage inside of a country that the embassy offers. That doesn't mean that it can be mismanaged, which I would say the State Department is guilty of many, many times. And it doesn't convene, it doesn't model inclusive leadership particularly well. I think there are many, many occasions when AID people could be in the lead. They could be selected by this process because they're best suited to this particular task that is being faced. So I happen to think that's one of the things that CSO could do, needs to do, and it will have the opportunity to do better, but not just as a coordinator. A coordinator is about the weakest position you can possibly have in the US government. I had somebody once tell me, don't ever, 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 ever accept the job of a coordinator, and I heard him. Because it's extraordinarily weak, unless you have the authority and some responsibility for the money. So I do believe that at the end of the day, one of the things that has to happen with an organization like CSO is that it has to have more influence about where the money is going as well. We've been an honest broker to F. We don't take most of the 1207 money that we had, we gave back to AID, we gave to AID and to INL. But when we're at the table, we're trying to figure out who's best suited to do this job, as opposed to, gee, can I have a little bit more money for my budget? That is a radically different outlook at most meetings, that if you go into the meeting and you're not trying to grab the money for yourself, it's very different. And I can't say that I've seen that behavior by many of my colleagues, irrespective of where they are. And so you have to have somebody in that role. I see an honest broker role. I see a need for a joint analysis. We can't have everybody running off and doing their own analysis. Because guess what? You send the refugee people there, or you send the AIDS people there, what do they always come back and say? They're always refugees and they're always AIDS. Of course there is. But what's most important? What's the common understanding of the problem? Because we can't take on the problem in all of its facets at the same time. So I believe that's another function that CSO can help with. Because I've seen the self-serving of the bureaucracy, and I've obviously been capable of doing it myself. But I think this particular function is designed to cut into that and to make sure we don't get in that direction. And Sarah will know personally from conversations I've had with her, my impatience with her when she made a highly bureaucratic argument to me about a team that we were sending to a country. I don't want to indulge that, and I don't think it's adult behavior to indulge it. But we do every day here in this town, and I think it's a real issue for us. I think the prioritized strategies have got to follow the common understanding. We can't say that every problem has the dimension of your what you bring to the toolkit.
So again, if every problem is if you've got a hammer, every problem's a nail.
Absolutely. Look, the United States shows up every time and it's 10 separate with 10 separate initiatives, and I've had ambassadors say to me, the only two people at this embassy that I feel are working for me right now are your two people. Because the whole rest of the portfolio is a legacy portfolio. It's been there for 5 or 10 years. And the problem that has just arisen that's most on his or her mind may not be addressed by the legacy portfolio. And one of the things that Terry did that was really unusual in Indonesia is he said, we actually have to flip our portfolio to fit the time. And they looked aggressively at actually making the portfolio more related to the transition problem facing the country rather than, of course, it has a health need, of course, it has all the other needs that were in the existing portfolio. That's very unusual, but it's not impossible because, look, Terry's still alive, and so then I would say the same thing for the objective review and the evaluation. I mean, you got to have somebody who sits outside of the system and hires their friends to evaluate their programs. Okay, that's another thing the CSO really probably should do long term, because otherwise, you know, everybody says that they had brilliant programming, and I don't think we really do that particularly well. So those are things that I think are still out there to be done, but it's going to take a while because there's just such an ingrained look. There are really ingrained attitudes. People have real attitudes, and whether it's insecurity or whether it's another attitude or whether it's arrogance. And that's pretty much the range from insecurity to arrogance. It covers just about everything I can think of. There's a lot of behavior in between. And anybody who's been there has seen it on a daily basis. And if you haven't, your level of denial is beyond my ability to address.
Okay. This is great, Rick, because I feel that, you know, this. So, okay, so let me ask one last question for you, and then we do have to end it, and people can chat with Rick. Afterwards, you mentioned something about institutional biases and perhaps even sort of almost industrial or sort of specific. Could you just push a little bit further on that issue of, you said, and some of this you've come up with, but you said, we have some huge institutional biases and some, in fact, even some in some organizations that are.
Sure.
Could you just push a little bit further on that, please?
Well, again.
Yes, okay, Terry, you get the, I'm going to give you the green shoe, so you get the.
Spent 35 years in aid, so excuse my biases on this. Sure. But I want to defend Sarah on the bureaucratic position.
Sure. Sure.
as a longtime bureaucrat. CSO, I think, as you pointed out, had terrific convening authority and much better than AID can
do
in convening. But we're pretty good on the operational side, in large part because you gave us a flexible, agile unit in OTI. I would set an example for the rest of the agency. It was very good. Do you think that in the future for CSO, if it focused on its convening power and its analytical power and left the operational programs and projects to implementing units like OTI, that it would overcome some of the bureaucratic infighting that CSO faced?
Yeah, you know, first off, I would say that particular piece of bureaucratic infighting has not been terribly debilitating. So it's an interesting one, but it's not one that has consumed a whole heck of a lot of my time. So just so you know, that somebody once said to me, maybe you, that 50% of my time, my diplomatic time, would be taken with diplomacy inside of the State Department. And I used that for a while, and then somebody came up to me and said, that's hopelessly naive. At least 80% of your time has to be. And I said, well, now I really understand my job, because 80% of my time is doing this, and the other 80% of my time is doing the rest of the job. But the tension, that tension has not been very great in my mind. But where I would push back, Terry, is this, that I don't believe that we should have monopolies of anything. Okay, it's just not a very American model. When we get monopolistic, we end up oftentimes with great inefficiencies. We worry about the inefficiencies of excessive duplication, and they're worth considering. But at the same time, when you get people who get in a groove and do things a certain way, you also get huge inefficiencies. So you want to keep. You want to at least have the opportunity to challenge conventions and to see if there are different ways of doing it. And of course, you want to go to the people who have the primary responsibility and say, are you capable of doing this and are you interested in doing it? And show me your sincerity in doing this. Of course, we want to get to that. But I don't believe that's not the natural model in Washington. An awful lot of people kind of hive off spaces and then get a bit static in their space. And I would say that would be true for sure of the State Department. And since I'm a card-carrying humanitarian, it's true of that community. I'm a card-carrying development person. It's true of that community. Card-carrying diplomat. It's true of that community. So, you know, I think a little bit of introspection here suggests that we actually need to not think so much in terms of comparative space, but competitive, because competitive actually keeps people a little bit more on edge, and they have to produce a little bit better product.
But then you have to have neutral adjudication.
Aha. Or engage leadership that does that.
But if you've got your own portfolio of projects, it's difficult for you to communicate.
Absolutely. But the portfolio was, as has been mentioned, the Kenyan portfolio was totally dependent on the partnership, the integrated partnership. So it wasn't, and probably it was an awkward moment because we had an ambassador that was separated from his mission at that point. And so there was a lot of work to be done, and we probably had a team that did nothing but kind of work through those relationships and actually bring a very fractured embassy more together. We can't take credit for having done it, but we were clearly among the few people whose job was dedicated to dealing with that fracture as opposed to dealing with their programming and everything else. So it comes, I think you've got to just, I mean, I've looked at it in terms of agility. You got a tool, why would you want to limit its approaches? I happen to think some of the programming can really produce among the best analysis out there. So the work we've done with the Syrians has been extraordinarily helpful early on to identifying who are some of the good partners. And those partners have been passed on to OTI and to others, and in theory, the whole program is now going to be passed on so that we will not continue as operators. So it would be a startup effort. I don't know that it's, I think you don't want to underestimate, I think one of the things that state does badly and the intelligence community does badly is underestimates how much learning we should be getting from a lot of AID's programs. That's not as institutionalized as it could be. So there's lots of room for strengthening here, but I honestly haven't found that to be a particularly distracting. Our people spend a lot of time working with their AID partners. We have joint missions that go out to do the analysis in most of these places. But it's one that I hear a lot about, but I haven't found it to be quite as distracting as I think others think it is.
Rick, we should stop here, but I know there are going to be folks that want to grab you bilaterally. I'm almost sure of that. Please join me in thanking Rick.
Thanks. Thank you.